Okay, so good morning, everybody. So I came all the way from Berkeley, which was a long trip. So I'm going to tell you this morning a little bit about what my lab is doing in single cells, and I know that there were already talks on that in this great workshop. So probably I don't need to convince you, but just to kind of put things in perspective, okay? The single cell perspective. So this is the traditional study, let's say up to like 2 years ago, right? We take a bunch of cells, we lyse them together, hundreds of thousands of cells, and we are interested in seeing some profile of these cells. For example, in this specific case, the RNA-seq, or the RNA of these cells. So we lyse them together, we do microarrays, RNA-seq, we get one vector right here, and of course this is the new and fancy technology that we can actually profile each and every individual cells and get a matrix like that of genes over cells. And what we are arguing is that actually no matter how to which extent a priori you expect this data to be heterogeneous or homogeneous, depending on the system that you study, be it like a cell line that you expect to be maybe very homogeneous, to whole tissues that you expect them to be very heterogeneous, you will always see some sort of variability in this matrix. And the question, the big question in the field is, what can this variability teach us, and is it even interesting? So of course, if we claim this variability is interesting, it can teach us a lot. And in order to start thinking about this variability, this is, I think, how we can phrase the big question that at least the computational people in the single cell field ask. Basically, we want to understand cell-to-cell variability by decoupling the sources that contribute to the variability. And these sources can be very interesting biological sources. For example, maybe we have discrete subtypes of cells. Maybe we have continuous phenotypes or spatial positioning. Maybe we have temporal processes that can be progressive or maybe can be fluctuating, like the cell cycle. In addition to that, there are other nuisance factors like technical factors in effect, and I'm going to talk quite a lot about that, genetic diversity, metabolic diversity, etc. So my group is basically trying to tackle different aspects of these sources of variation and develop tools that allow us to characterize them and to learn something from them. So I'm going to mention a couple of these tools during my talk. The one that I'm not going to mention is this one, Trapez. We actually have this tool to reconstruct T-cell receptors from single-cell RNA sequencing. Unfortunately, I will not have time to tell you about that today. So we have a number of projects in the lab that we are studying different systems using single-cell perspective, primarily on immune response. And I've chosen today to tell you about this story right here, the TH17 story that was published recently. And what I'm going to do, I'm going to try to use this story to kind of put it on the narrative and see and try to explain where the different tools that we develop, where do they match in some sort of like standard single cell study and where they can actually be useful. So let's talk a little bit about T cells. So this is the subject of our studies. These cells are called TH17 cells. They were discovered about, these are T helper cells, and they were discovered about 10 years ago. And since their discovery, they became a very popular subset of cells because people are finding quite often that they are very potent inducers of tissue inflammation and really play a central role in pathogenesis of multiple autoimmunities like psoriasis and multiple sclerosis. So the big question that we started, and I started working on this system as a postdoc, was this ask, okay, let's look at this process by which a naive T cell differentiates into TH17 cells and by which TH17 cell is actually carrying this pathogenic function. What regulates this process and what regulates the pathogenic activity? So that's the first question that we started up with. And we did do quite a lot of studies on that and found some models for the regulatory network that controls the differentiation process and the network that actually is responsible for keeping these cells stable and active. For example, here we found this positive feedback loop that really characterizes the active state of these cells. And if you turn on this positive feedback, for example, by treating the cells with sodium, you actually generate these inflammatory responses. And I'm going to get back to this specific example later. That's why I'm mentioning it. So that was all nice and well, but since this study was published, the field kind of evolved, and basically the emerging picture is that our definition for what is a TH17 cell, our dictionary definition, is maybe not that accurate, or maybe too general. So under the umbrella of TH17 cells, there are actually many different subtypes of T cells. And now you ask yourself, okay, well, why is that interesting? It's interesting because the different subtypes can have very different functionality. And specifically, what people have shown is that under some conditions, what falls under the definition of Th17 cells can be very pathogenic. Under other conditions, it can be non-pathogenic or even repressive. And then I call it the Th17 conundrum, because if you look at the literature from the past couple of years, it's actually pretty confusing. There are a lot of arguments. Some say they are very plastic cells. Some say, no, they are not plastic. Some say they are short-lived, terminally differentiated. Some say, no, they are long-lived and self-renewing. So what is going on here? So, of course, you can now imagine why this is a very good model system for single-cell analysis. The question that we ask is whether these kind of ambiguities are actually reflected in different subtypes of Th17 cells. But of course, that we didn't have any handle of that. Who are these subtypes, right? Who are the cell surface markers that we can use to characterize them? So this is why basically we want to do single-cell RNA-seq. The question that we want to ask is, are these properties reflected in the differences between subpopulations? And if they are, can we identify new drivers that are specific to the pathogenic fate of the cells? And instead of just killing the entire compartment, which can be detrimental, we can think about therapies that that are specific to this subset of these T cells. Yes?
I'm just trying to can't understand what the definitions of all these terms are. So what is when is it pathogenic? When is it?
We say that it's based on the effect or function of the T cell. So T cell secretes to the environment, it secretes cytokines that basically guide the operation of the immune system, right? So certain molecules that the T cell will secrete will cause a strong immune response. Other molecules would actually suppress the immune response. So we can think about it in a categorical way. Based on the cytokine that are, or you know, molecules that are produced by the cell, we can somehow infer what would be the effect of that cell on the immune system. Does that make sense?
So pathogenic means
it pathogenic means that it immune system. That it creates an immune response. Yes, that induces an immune response. Okay. So this is the study. So you can see we have, you know, about 6,000 genes, about 800 cells from various conditions. And I'm in the interest of time, I'm not going to go into the whole story. I'm just going to give you one vignette out of this story. But now basically the premise is, our idea is to take this matrix and try to see if we can tease out subpopulation of these cells. But before we go and we try to analyze this big matrix, we need to remember that it is very, very heavily confounded by nuisance factors that we have to account before we start working with this matrix. And these nuisance factors can come from batch effect. They can come from the fact that each and every one of these columns is a different RNA-seq library that have a different quality. It can come from the crazy effect that can come because of the amplification. We start in very low amounts of RNA. And I'm going to talk about, so we did some preliminary analysis here in this specific work, and I'm going to talk about SCORN, which is a tool we developed in the lab that goes and does this in a bit more comprehensive way. So that will come after I finish this story. Let's say that we normalized our cells. We have a normalization kind of thing in mind. So this is how one of the assays go. We induce the differentiation of these cells in the plate. We get those cells, and then we do single-cell RNA-seq. We get about 130 cells. We take these cells. We do principal component analysis. After we clean all of the confounding factors from the data, we get this thing right here. And now we can look at that and scratch our heads and ask, what can this observability actually teach us? So in a sense, what you would ideally like to do is to put some sort of legend on this map and say, okay, this is, put some semantics on this map and interpret the meaning of the different directions that we see here. So in order to do that, we did a very simple exercise. And the simple exercise was refer to the literature. There are already a lot of literature on these cells using RNA-seq data, from populations. So, for example, take cells from pathogenic, from an inflammatory response, and compare them to cells that have a regulatory effect, and just compare the profile to each other with RNA-seq, get a bunch of genes, the ones that are up in the pathogenic condition, the ones that are up in the regulatory condition, and take these genes, use them as signature, and use that signature to give every cell a signature score. That basically, you can think about it as the expression of these genes divided by the expression of those genes on log space. And then basically for every cell, you have some sort of a positioning on the location, between this phenotype and that phenotype. Where is it positioned? So of course we can do this exercise for any possible signature, for random set signatures. So the question is, which one of them gives us interesting information, which one of them actually vary in the data in a way that is interesting. So we have this kind of heuristic way to determine that using a one versus all gene set enriched analysis. And at the end of the day, we come up with a bunch of signatures that give us they are much more diverse in the data, much more heterogeneous than what we expect to see by chance. So these are the signatures that we actually want to follow up on and see how they behave. Now, one thing that was actually very surprising for me to see is that a lot of these signatures that come up from this analysis actually are captured very, very strongly by just the first two principal components. So this is here as an example for comparing pathogenic versus non-pathogenic cells. And we can see that if we take the pathogenic score of the cells, the signature score of the cells on the x-axis and plot it against the first principal component on the y-axis, we can see, this striking correlation between them. That means that the principal components actually capture the variability that is inherent in those signatures that we find. So that was encouraging, and that basically allowed us to actually plot all of these signatures on top of the principal component map. So here, basically, the cells are colored according to their pathogenicity score. And you can see that we have this very, very coherent story from, going from like a very non-pathogenic effector function to a very pathogenic effector function. And that, again, to your question, depends on the kind of cytokines that we see that is being produced by those cells versus these cells. And we see a lot of other effects here that really support this story, make it a very coherent story. For example, if you look at the signature of what happens when you treat the cells with sodium, we see that basically it takes us in this direction. But if we knock out this, if you look at the knockout of some of the components of this pathway, we go exactly on the opposite direction. So it gives us, again, kind of a very nice legend, a very nice way to actually look at this map and try to, and interpret what does it mean in terms of the biology of these cells. Now, we found this kind of analysis to be very useful. So this is one of the tools that was developed in the lab. It's called FastProject, where basically automates this whole process of looking at single-cell data in two dimensions and then putting semantics, putting some biological interpretation on these two-dimensional projections. And basically what it does, it's just a big report that looks at many, many different ways that we can project cells in two dimensions. And for each one of those ways, it says, okay, these are the signatures that characterize, that they have significant relationship or are being captured by this two-dimensional projection of the data. So basically give us some coherent pictures like that, where the cells are colored by their signature score. So I'm doing a bit of injustice for this because there is a lot of processes that have been done before we get to this final report. In the interest of time, I won't describe it, but actually this tool is already available on a GitHub from the lab. So going back to the T cells. So far, what we've done was basically just use prior knowledge, okay? We plotted the cells in two dimensions, and then we said, okay, let's take all the prior knowledge that we know and embed it in this map and try to interpret what it is that we see. But now, of course, this is maybe, it's nice to see that, but it's not very interesting. What's interesting is to see if we can find something new. And here we can go back and say, okay, in addition to these signatures, we also have the rest of the transcriptome, okay? So now let's look at these cells and ask, okay, what else is different between the cells that are here and the cells that are there, in a sense. All right, so that's exactly the exercise that we did, and that also involved not only this data, but additional data sets that we had in this study. And when we did that, we were able to make some hypotheses about new genes that we think that are regulators or that are specific to the pathogenic state of these cells. And we've done this and with our colleagues. We've done some follow-up analysis for four of these genes, and this is just one example for one of these genes. It's called CD5L. So basically, it's an inducer it's a regulator of lipid metabolism that we see that it's only expressed in non-pathogenic conditions, but it correlates very strongly with the pathogenic signature of the cells, which led us to believe that it is a negative regulator. It basically acts as a brake to break the development of a pathogenic phenotype in these cells. And indeed, what we've shown is that if you knock it out, the mice that we study actually develop much more severe autoimmunity. So here in the x-axis, you see the days after the induction of a mouse model of multiple sclerosis. On the y-axis, you see how sick the mice are, and basically you see that the knockout mice develop much more severe inflammation. And there is a model that we, that you know, we, with our colleagues, we came up with, which is basically that we see some sort of a signaling cascade that starts from this molecule, CD5L, through controlling the balance of production of fatty acids in the cell that at the end propagates to the regulating the activity of a main transcription factor that leads to separation between either you know, inducing pathogenic genes or inducing non-pathogenic genes. So this is just a kind of a short story about you know, how can you basically how can single cell RNA-seq how this can this paradigm actually help us to learn new biology and start with this kind of a confusing idea of what is it, what do these cells actually do? And I didn't talk about these two, but we actually were able to make some inference about these two as well. And try to tease out subpopulation, try to tease out specific mechanisms that are relevant to specific subpopulations. So now I just I want to go back to I want to go back to the methodology. After we gave some you know, some context of why these things are important and why these things are useful. So as we said, you know, there are many things that that at the end affect the variability that we see in this matrix of cells over genes. And one of them, of course, is are the technical factors, which I mentioned before. Basically, when we try to characterize, you know, what are the main technical factors that we see, so we have two main things that we can think of. The first one is very strong zero inflation that we see in the data, basically a lot of false negatives. And these false negatives come just from selection bias. Basically, if you have, from selection efficiency. Okay, if you have only, let's say, five transcripts of a given gene in the cell, and you're only sampling, you know, your sampling efficiency is only maybe 5% of the transcript in the cell, so you're quite likely just to miss that gene, not because it's not expressed, but just because it's expressed on low copies, on low copy number, and so on. So this is something that is very, very prevalent in single-cell RNA-seq data, false negatives. The second one is the fact, again, that each one of these columns, each one of these cells is a different library, and it can have different number of reads, different complexity, different 3-to-5' bias, and these things can very strongly influence our analysis. And sometimes you will see, you know, reports where you see some clustering of single-cell data, but the difference between the cluster is just the number of reads in the library. So we need to account for those things. And to account for those things, this is where we use SCON, a single cell of the view of normalized expression package. SCON has a number of steps that it uses, that implements in order to normalize the single cell data. So it starts by evaluating false negative rates, then it filters bad libraries or noisy genes, impute the data, scales it, and adjusts for technical confounders. And let me just show you some of the, you know, just a few of the steps that it does. So let's start with estimation of false negative rates. Okay, so this is the original matrix. Okay, you see these are the cells, these are the genes, and you see that there are a lot of zeros here. Now the question is, from which the numbers of these matrix? This is gene expression. Okay, so it can be like transcripts per million, for example. Okay, TPM. Some sort of measurement, standard measurement that you are getting from
TPM reads.
Yeah.
So how do you get those numbers?
So you get those numbers, you know, let's say for the sake of this discussion, there's basically just the number of reads that fall on every gene. Okay, you just count these numbers. And this normalization is maybe because you're doing some scaling, so just divide every cell by a constant, so that's why you're getting things that are maybe not integer. Okay? So these are just some indication for, you know, for the, you know, the expression level of every gene. And we see a lot of zeros here in this matrix, which means that, you know, but the question is, should we believe these zeros or not? What is the confidence that we can put on each one of those zeros? That's what we want to get at the end, some reliability for which one of those observations, whether we believe it's actually true or not. And the idea is to model the probability of a dropout by this logistic function that basically for every gene, it says the probability that you be dropped out depends on several factors. And these factors are your average expression. Okay, if you are a very lowly expressed gene, maybe I think that you are more likely to be dropped out. Gene length, again, if you are a short gene, maybe you are more likely to be dropped out. The GC content, again, has the same, you know, the same, with the same wisdom from the biases that we see in RNA-seq. And of course, we also have a component for cell sensitivity, because this is for gene I, I'm sorry, gene J and cell I. So we have this kind of overall formulation of how we actually can compute the false negative rates for every gene. And then we embed that in this model. We can think about it as a mixture of two events. Either we can measure the gene, and then the distribution is a negative binomial, very nice negative binomial, or we cannot measure the gene, and then basically we see a zero. Okay, so the zero can come from the negative binomial. Okay, maybe the gene is just not expressed by the cell, but it can also come from the zero inflation. So that's basically what this model is expressed. And we, through EM, we can basically fit this model and learn the parameters. So now, basically, you have a question?
Oh, no.
Okay, so now basically we have these rates. Okay, so we have Pi ij that basically gives us for every for gene j for cell I, what is the probability that this gene was dropped when I measure that cell, that it's a false negative. So I can put this pi ij here in the matrix. Okay, these are all the pi ij's in red. And now the question is, what can I do with those pi ij's, right? So the first thing that I can do is filtering, right? I can just sum over the rows, or sum the columns, and get an overall estimation for false negative rates in a gene or in a cell. And then I can say, okay, I'm putting some cutoff, and I'm just removing the ones that are very noisy and I'm not confident about from the analysis. Okay, so I did that. But then, what can I do with those genes? Right, so there are two things that you can think about doing, with those estimates. Two things that you can think about. The one thing is just to keep the zeros in the matrix. Keep them. But in every subsequent analysis you're going to do, you're going to weigh down the effect of these zeros on your analysis. So for example, if you want to do PCA, so you look at a weighted covariance matrix where you're weighing down the effect of these zeros, and so on. And this is just a very simple way to just derive from the negative binomial, just derive these probability for dropouts. The second option is imputation. So basically take these zeros and replace them by the estimated value, which is basically the probability for the dropout times the expected population mean. So these are two different strategies, right? Which one is better? I don't know. It really depends, and we'll see exactly how we handle this selection between different strategies. The second thing I want to tell you about is the quality factor analysis, right? So as we said before, the signal in the data may be dominated by known technical artifacts. So, and what we can see here, this is in basically every single cell data set that I looked at, we see the same picture. Where here you have the principal components from the data. And here, this is a log p-value, log 10 p-value of correlation, Spearman correlation. And each one of these bars is each one of those technical covariates. So we see, for example, the number of reads very strongly correlates with the first principal component, right? And the complexity very strongly correlates also with the first and the second principal components, and so on, right? So that means that we have to take these things into account before we do any analysis on the data. So basically, the way that we think about doing that is decomposing the matrix, very simply. Basically, just regress on these values right here and remove it from the data, right? But then you can say, okay, but you know, you have all of these technical factors here, but maybe they are not capturing all of the technical artifacts in the data. Maybe they are unobserved, unwanted variation in the data. Another way to do that is to use tools from the RNA sequencing literature, like RUV, for example, that computes hidden technical covariates by looking at housekeeping genes and assuming that these genes should not vary between the cells, right? So we can do that as well. We can add another decomposition, another part to our decomposition, basically based on filtering out the variants that we can see for housekeeping genes, right? That's another thing that we can do. But then you can say, oh, but shouldn't, maybe these two, maybe they're a little bit redundant. And you're right. If you just plot the two sources of variation against each other, this is in a data set from our Brain Initiative project where we have two types of neurons. So these are basically just two biological conditions. You can think about the red and the blue. So, but these two types of variation actually correlate quite a lot with each other. So now you can say, no, they're redundant. Maybe you should, you know, only use one of them. The question is which one you should use, right? And in this specific case, we can see that actually, if I'm going to remove this one, the hidden technical covariate one, the based on RUV, I'm actually going to lose a lot of the biology when I do that. Whereas basically a lot of the differences that I see between these two samples. Whereas if I'm going to remove the observed technical covariates, I'm not going to lose that information. Okay, but this is specific to that case. It's not always the case, right? So now the question is, okay, I have all of these ways to normalize the data. What am I going to do? So that's basically the idea of SCone. The reality of normalization, this is something that we are trying to show in all sorts of ways, is that no single method fits all cases. So you have all sorts of ways to estimate false negative rates, all sorts of ways that I didn't talk about, to do scaling, to do factor-based normalization, and our way is basically to try many, many methods. And of course, so basically you take the Cartesian product of this process here, you get a lot of different options, and the challenge is, you know, how to test and evaluate all of these multiple methods. And the idea is basically to use criteria that, given a normalization method, I'm going to tell you how good it is. Okay, so we have you can see something like 8 different ways that we can evaluate a given normalization method. So, for example, to what extent it retains the baseline that I know about the biology. For example, I know that I have 2 types of cells in my data, right? Or to what extent it eliminates the effect of technical factors of my data. Or the resulting matrix, how well it lends itself to clustering. So we have all of these ways to look at the data, and basically by aggregating over all of these different criteria, we are able to say, okay, these are the best normalization methods that you can think of. And another nice thing that can come out of it is if you just take this matrix and you just do PCA of this matrix and look at the B plot, you can start seeing the tension between the different criteria, right? So here in this data, I can tell you, we have a little bit of a problem, right? We can see that there is almost like a dichotomy between, you know, if you want to, retain the biology, you want to go this way. But if you want to control the batch, you have to go that way. Right? So there is a tension between eliminating the batch and retaining the biology, because maybe this data wasn't, you know, the experimental design here was maybe not perfect, okay? But still, by doing this kind of analysis, we can highlight exactly, you know, we can suggest, you know, what are the best methods for normalization that we can use. And all of these things, you know, so it's to be released as a bioconductor package that gives you a lot of these kind of reports from all of the statistics that I've shown you. I don't have time to talk about closely, but it has also additional faces, things that I didn't talk about, like, you know, ways to do clustering in a stable manner and so on. So all of this kind of a complete package that we already released to some of our collaborators and we want to release out in the next couple of months. We hope to show it in the next Bioconductor conference in June. So this is just to show you that it works on the data. Basically, this is before normalization. We can see that we don't see a nice separation between the two different biological conditions when you just do PCA, but we do see a very strong correlation between the technical quality of the cells and the first principle component in the data. And this is what happens after we do the normalization. We see a nice separation, and we don't see any correlation between the first principle component and the technical factors of the data. Now, I just want to finish with going back to the biology. I know that I have. I just want to leave you with that. Something that I'm, very excited about. A project is going on in the lab. I know this is a transcriptional workshop, but we need to remember that, you know, when we look at gene expression, it can actually teach us a lot about other processes in the cells that are very important, and specifically metabolism, right? So when we look at T cells, and we said, okay, we found this metabolic gene, right, that regulates lipid metabolism, and then, you know, we tried to rationalize why it works, we immediately thought about signaling. We immediately thought about how it relates to transcriptional regulation. But there can be alternative explanations. We know, especially in the context of T cells, that there are differences between T cells that have a pathogenic function and T cells that are regulatory. And these differences, for example, a transition from oxidative phosphorylation in these cells to glycolysis in the pathogenic cells, right? And these are very important differences. And what the thing is that the RNA sequencing can actually teach us about those things. And I will just give you a snapshot. The idea is basically to use flux balance analysis, do metabolic modeling in single cells, and basically using the knowledge that we have about modeling metabolic processes, actually come up with some hypothesis for every single cell. What is the capacity of these cells? What is the potential of these cells to produce to each and every metabolite that we can model in this network? It's several hundred metabolites. So that basically gives us some sort of a transformation from the gene expression domain to the metabolic domain, and we actually find it to be very useful and very informative when we look at T cells. So when we look at the variability between the single cells that I've shown you before, and we look at it in the metabolic domain rather than the gene expression domain, we can see this very nice transition that I told you before, like from oxidative phosphorylation to glycolysis. We find additional other very interesting stories that I don't have time to talk about. And this is something that is ongoing, that is currently we're actually targeting selected metabolic pathways that we see that kind of vary between the cells. And I guess this is to be continued. So just to acknowledge in my lab, the people that were working on these various projects. So the SCORN is being written by Michael Cole from my lab and David Ariso from Sandrine Dudois' lab here in Berkeley. And this is in collaboration with Elizabeth Purdom and John Nye. The T-cell project that I've shown you was done in joint work with Aviv Regev from the Broad Institute and Vijay Kuchu from Harvard. Both of them are my postdoc advisors. Collaborators at the MIT and Reagan, Alex Shalek and Shu Yu, we are doing together again a lot of work on single cells. And thank you very much for listening.
The bit at the end about metabolism, how does that differ from existing ways that people use bulk expression data with metabolic flux analysis? Because I think
that's a good question. So it's basically the idiosyncrasies of single cells, right? How do you handle dropouts, and how do you handle basically the noise that is inherent in those cells and in order to make these inference more stable? And how do you account for multiple solutions that you can have? Basically, you can get these very big polytopes that basically you maximize your function. So, and if you have now, you know, 1,000 cells with this very big range of metabolic states for every cell, how do you combine this together? So these are the challenges that we had to approach when we were addressing this, yes.
But I mean, so for like the metabolism, it really matters whether the protein is there, right? And whether the mRNA was there or not, you know, your protein is already a time average of the mRNA is there, right? So there's a lot of steps in between.
That's a very good point. And what we are trying to do basically is to say, I mean, that's a very good point. And one thing that you can say, you know, transcription can be bursty. Right, and maybe, you know, in 1 minute you see the RNA, maybe 10 minutes later you will not see it in the same cell. So the idea is that you do some sort of averaging, you look at the cell, but do some averaging on the neighboring cells next to it. By making the assumption that if you look at a neighborhood of a lot of cells that are kind of similar to each other, you are getting something that reflects the steady state distribution of that stochastic process. So from that you can infer whether there is, so basically by averaging information from neighboring cells, you can infer that even when I see a zero, maybe I still have some amount of protein in the cell, if that makes sense.
I know what you say you do, but I mean there's a huge amount of assumptions going on.
Yeah, absolutely. And I think that in general, you know, the assumption, you know, going from mRNA to protein and so on, that's a big assumption that been done by these kind of models. Yes. That's true. It's a very good point.
Okay. Let's thank Nir again, and we'll take more questions during the break.